Eastern Finland will talk on moral psychology and animal philosophy. Please.
Can everybody hear me? Am I speaking? Right, so first of all, I found out yesterday. Sorry, I have to apologize for my cough. I have had a cold for maybe 2 weeks, so my voice is quite odd. Hopefully, I can speak for an hour. Let's see how it goes. And secondly, I was told yesterday that Aaltola means something else in Italian. Stay away or something. Don't follow that order. I'm perfectly friendly. I changed the topic of my talk just now on impulse after I heard the two previous talks. So I was going to talk about something else, but I have a few presentations on my memory stick, and this is a presentation I did in another university a few weeks ago, so I'm going to go with this one because it's more broad and more understandable to those who do not have a philosophy background. And I'm just going to really briefly talk about the rise of sentimentalism in philosophy. So my talk will be about animal philosophy and the role of emotions in contemporary animal ethics and philosophy, and particularly empathy. But before I get there, I'm going to do a really short historical preview over why do we talk of empathy these days at all? What's the historical context for suddenly discussing empathy in philosophy? And of course, I have to mention the really heavily accentuated emphasis on reason that modern philosophy and modern culture has witnessed. So rationalism has been the chosen school of thought for much of Western philosophy. And this has had a huge impact on the way that we view other animals too. So human beings have been understood to be primarily rational, reason-orientated creatures. And via this emphasis, the claim has also been that reason forms the basis of moral agency. So it is via reason, via rationality, that human beings become moral creatures. Morality is based, founded upon reason. Nothing else, no emotions have value or relevance when it comes to morality. And this was, of course, really heavily emphasized by Immanuel Kant, who still has a very strong hold on particularly analytical moral theory. And his idea was that morality is grounded on reason and autonomy. So those creatures who are capable of autonomous action, rationality, are moral creatures. The rest are left somewhere outside. And here, emotions are very marginalized. They become quite insignificant. So Kant is famous for arguing that if a perfectly sympathetic person who is very compassionate and happens to do the right thing, but doesn't rationally understand why he does that thing, we cannot talk of moral agency. Whereas if a perfectly cold, rational, reason-orientated person does the right action but has no sympathy, we can talk of moral agency. So only a cold, reason-orientated human individual is ultimately the idea of moral agency. Sympathy, empathy, emotions have very little bearing. Of course, Kant talked of goodwill, but it has to do with something else, not sympathy or empathy. And the impact this emphasis on reason has had on animals is quite obvious. First of all, it has led to an ontological division, a dualistic metaphysics within which we distinguish reason-orientated creatures such as humans from all of animality. So humans and animals are set into completely separate categories. And this forms the grounds for anthropocentrism, the idea that humans are something quite spectacular in their capacity for rationality. And secondly, it has epistemological ramifications. And here the idea is that since other animals are presumed to be non-reason orientated, that they lack rationality, the assumption also is that we cannot understand other animals. And this has led to a very strong tradition of skepticism within philosophy. And the basic claim of skepticism is that humans cannot understand other animals. So Ludwig Wittgenstein, for instance, was famous for claiming that even if a lion could speak, we could not understand her. There is a huge abyss between humans and other animals when it comes to understanding. And this again is formed on the idea that only humans are reason-orientated. Since other animals are non-rational creatures, they cannot be understood. And the third and most important aspect here is the normative. So because human beings are understood to be rational and non-human creatures are understood not to be rational, the claim is that only humans have value in themselves. Only human beings have intrinsic value. Rest of animals lack value, other than perhaps instrumental or indirect value. The basis of a valuable creature is humanity, and here reason is the ground force. So rationalism has had a huge, really intricate effect on how we perceive other animals. But when I talk of the long history of rationalism, we of course have to remember that sentimentalism has a hugely long history in Western philosophy too. And David Hume is the most prominent classic when it comes to sentimentalism. And he actually argued that empathy is the basis of moral agency. He used the term sympathy because empathy, as we heard earlier, as a concept is relatively new, but he used this concept of sympathy in a very similar sense than we talk of empathy these days. I'm going to get to that later, what empathy means. And for Hume, morality is grounded on emotions, and particularly our capacity to sympathize. Emotions lay the foundations for moral agency. And it is by sympathy or empathy that we start to perceive value also in other emotional animals. He didn't really talk of animals and their value, but he emphasized very keenly the broad spectrum of animal cognition and emotion and experience. And it's quite clear that if he had been consistent with his moral theory, he would have taken animals into account more seriously too. So Hume offered a completely opposite understanding of the grounds of morality in comparison to Kant. And this tradition of sentimentalism was really prominent in the animal context in the 18th and 19th century, where humanitarianism started to accentuate empathy and sympathy and compassion quite keenly. And humanitarianism as a movement, of course, was mainly based on seeing value in previously marginalized human groups, such as small children or women, or the working class, or the mentally handicapped, or the prisoners, people of other skin color. But humanitarianism as a historical phenomenon also included other animals, non-human animals. And this is where we see the birth of the modern animal welfare movement. Now the interesting thing is that humanitarianism was largely founded on the tradition of sentimentalism. So humanitarians were much grounded on the idea that it is emotion that renders us into moral creatures. And they went so far with this that they argued that humanity lacking compassion or sympathy is not humanity at all. That a key feature of human beings is their capacity to sympathize, to feel compassion for other creatures. And so sentimentalism has had clear historical political impact on the way that animals, but also marginalized human groups, are valued. Sentimentalism has played a huge part in this. However, in the contemporary culture, sentimentalism is usually viewed as a negative term. If you want to mock somebody, you call them sentimental. Reference to emotion is seen as a form of ridicule when we talk of morality. And so, really, the aura or the connotations of sentiment, sentimentalism, emotions are highly negative. And perhaps there's a time for re-evaluation in philosophy too. And this has been happening. There's been quite a significant revival of sentimentalism in the last few decades. And it started in philosophy from women's studies. Carol Killigan and Genevieve Lloyd are quite famous and well known for their studies on how emotions in Western thinking have been linked to women. And their main argument is, particularly the argument of Genevieve Lloyd, is that reason has been celebrated in Western philosophy because it has been linked to the masculine identity. Men have been culturally constructed as reason-orientated, rational, autonomous, neutral, non-emotive beings, whereas women have been classified emotional, embodied, closer to nature than culture. And this correlation between rationality and masculinity and emotions and femininity is a cultural one and has, in the opinion of many women's studies scholars, had the impact of Western culture, largely written by men, emphasizing reason all the time, bringing forward the idea of the ideal masculinity, the detached, emotionally cold, calculative, even mechanic rationality. And in animal ethics, already from the 1980s, this women's studies view has brought forward the role of emotions. Equal feminists and care theory scholars have emphasized how emotions are really valuable in moral thinking and in thinking in general. The argument is that we cannot separate emotions and reason categorically at all. And here the work of Martha Nussbaum too is quite significant. She's a famous philosopher in the States who has written many books on the relevance of emotion, even in rational thought. Now, the claim that has been brought forward by eco-feminists and care theorists has been that even animal ethics has been too reason-orientated, that animal philosophy has concentrated too much on rationality. So the most classic thinkers of animal ethics, Peter Singer and Tom Regan, in their opinion, have been overly rationalistic. They have ignored the role of emotion. Now, sentimentalism has gained huge interest in the past few years in philosophy in general, not only in animal philosophy, but philosophy in general. And here the hard sciences, empirical sciences, have had a function. Social psychology, neurology, psychiatry have all begun to study quite fiercely the impact that emotions have on moral decision making. And the results are breathtaking. It seems that 90% of our moral judgments are emotion based. Reason is mainly used in cases of conflict or when we try and justify our actions to others. Now, it's not only emotions that form this 90%, also intuitions and cultural stereotypes are important. But even in intuitions and cultural stereotypes, emotions often play a pivotal part. So we have racist cultural stereotypes or sexist cultural stereotypes because of certain learned emotions towards different groups of people. Emotions are extremely central to moral decision making on a descriptive empirical level. And partly this has led to an effective turn in philosophy, in moral psychology in particular. So we speak of the linguistic turn having taken place in the 20th century. Now we talk of an effective turn. Suddenly there's rising intense interest on the role of emotions in human thought. And particularly the role of empathy is significant and interesting. If emotions govern so much of our moral decision-making, what function does empathy serve? the empirical studies that have found out that majority of moral decision making is based on emotions, they have emphasized the role of disgust, anger, hatred, contempt, love, elevation, a huge variety of different emotions. But this is all done on a descriptive level. And in philosophy, of course, we need to ask prescriptively, normatively, which emotion should govern moral decision making. So even if we agree with philosophers like Jesse Prince, who argues that anger is the most kind of generic moral emotion that we have, the most influential moral emotion that we have, this doesn't mean that it ought to be that. We have to think, which emotions do we want to prescriptively emphasize? And here, empathy has been brought forward as one obvious candidate. And this is because empathy enables other directedness and openness, terms that I will come to later. And, well, I'm going to skip this one, actually. I'm going to speak of four different types of empathy in order to map out which of them might have a moral bearing, which of them might have centrality when it comes to the prescriptive level. And first I'm going to discuss affective empathy. This is the form of empathy that Hume talked of. So David Hume, when he used the term sympathy, was speaking of sympathy in a very similar way that contemporary theorists use affective empathy. And to describe what affective empathy is, I'm going to go back to Hume. And he argued that we form ideas on the basis of impressions of other creatures, human beings mainly. And these impressions mean sensory perceptions of others. So we can witness impressions on another human being. We can see by our senses that they are undergoing something. And this leads into an idea concerning that emotional or experiential content. And this idea, again, can be something like suffering or joy, leads into an impression in ourselves, a sensed experience in ourselves. So basically, when we see impressions in others, we get the sense, perception, that they are undergoing suffering. We form the idea of suffering in our minds. And after this, the idea travels into our own body. It becomes felt in ourselves. And this is something that Hume called reverberation. And in contemporary literature, it's often referred to as resonation. So we resonate with the emotional contents of other individuals. It's as if waves were hitting a reef by a shore in a lake. The reef begin to move with the waves, and this is resonation, emotive experiential resonation. And Hume really celebrated this capacity in human beings. There's a quote here. He argued that minds can be mirrors to one another, not only because they reflect each other's emotions, but also because those rays of passions, sentiments, and opinions may often be reverberated. And this was in a treatise. He called this the most spectacular feature in humanity. So for him, the capacity to resonate with others forms, ultimately, the grounds for morality. Of course, various other emotions are pivotal too, and virtues grounded on those emotions. But this very simple capacity to resonate has the key function in his idea. There's much evidential support for affective empathy in contemporary empirical sciences. Psychiatry and neurosciences have been really interested in affective empathy. It seemed to be something mystical before. So before, in the earlier decades or centuries, when this sort of resonation was referred to, it seemed to be senseless, it seemed to be mystical, it seemed to assume too much of human capacity. But hard sciences are showing that it's very common, it's hardwired into most of us. And indeed, if it's not hardwired into us, there's something fundamentally wrong with us. And here, effective empathy refers to the immediate contagion of emotions between individuals, but one where we know the source of those emotions. So emotional contagion simplistically means that if somebody else is crying, we start to get tearful. In effective empathy, we know the reason why, and this makes it something different from pure emotional contagion. And neurologically, neurons have been celebrated as the physical grounds of effective empathy. And the next form of empathy that I will discuss is cognitive empathy. And it's quite opposite to effective empathy. It refers to the neutral observation or inference or perception of mental contents in others. So we, from a quite detached perspective, can perceive emotions in others, or we can infer those emotions while using our reasoning ability. And I really have to emphasize that this can remain utterly and completely detached and neutral. There might not be any resonation at all taking place in cognitive empathy. Therefore, we can quite neutrally observe that somebody is in pain, or somebody is happy, or somebody is in a state of joy or sorrow, and feel nothing for them. This is cognitive empathy in its most basic form. And this is an important distinction to remember. I'm going to come back to both effective empathy and cognitive empathy later, and the moral relevance. And this detachment is really important for understanding cognitive empathy in the moral context. And the third type of empathy that I will mention is projective empathy. I should really emphasize here still that cognitive empathy is based on theory of mind. So, because with these other forms of empathy I'm mentioning famous philosophers as their source, I have to here accentuate the fact that also cognitive empathy does have philosophical ramifications, and that is a theory of mind. So we can only have cognitive empathy if we can understand that we are minded creatures and other individuals are similarly minded creatures. We have to constantly refer back to a theory of mind. But then to the third one, projective empathy. And projective empathy is quite common, as is effective empathy and cognitive empathy too. And it's particularly celebrated in the animal context for reasons that are perhaps mistaken, as I will argue later. Projective empathy means the capacity to simply project oneself into the context or situation of another creature. So we try and imagine what it would be like to be that other creature. Adam Smith, the famous forefather of liberal political theory, greatly celebrated projective empathy. He wrote a whole book on this matter, The Theory of Moral Sentiments, where he scrutinizes what projective empathy could mean. And as a curiosity, his idea of the invisible hand of free market relations could only work as long as people had projective empathy. Again, he used the term sympathy. He was a friend of Hume. Both of them used the term sympathy in a different way. But the way that Smith utilize this concept comes very close to contemporary understanding of projective empathy. And projective empathy is really grounded on simulation. We try and simulate the situation of other creatures. We imagine what it would be like to be them. And this again leads to an affective state. So while you're projecting and simulating the context and setting of other creatures, we begin to experience something that we assume those other creatures to be undergoing. So we begin to experience the similar mental states as they are experiencing. At least this is what we presume. And whereas Hume really celebrated effective empathy, Smith is a keen advocate of the idea that precisely projective empathy is the source of morality. And there's a quote here from him: "As we have no immediate experience of what other men feel, we can form no idea of the manner in which they are affected. But by conceiving what we ourselves should feel in the like situation." So what he's arguing is that we cannot understand others at all unless we use projection. We don't resonate with them. We don't only infer what they might be undergoing. We have to project. Projection is the grounds of understanding other individuals. And thereby it's also the grounds for moral agency. And the fourth candidate for empathy that I'm going to mention is embodied empathy. And embodied empathy is something that stems from the phenomenological tradition in philosophy. Ralph Akinbora, who will be speaking later, has brought this notion of embodied empathy to animal philosophy. And phenomenologists were quite renowned for celebrating the idea that empathy as a capacity, or understanding others as a capacity, is something grounded on our bodies, the unit of a body-mind, wherein bodies are continually communicating the contents of minds to others. And I have Mark Scheler here as an example. He also wrote a whole book on empathy, again using the term sympathy, but in a very similar manner as embodied empathy is discussed these days. And his starting point is the idea that the problem of other minds is absurd. I mentioned in the beginning that skepticism has a long tradition in Western philosophy, and particularly a long tradition when it comes to understanding animal minds. Well, for Scheler, skepticism is simply absurd. It's asking the wrong question. It's something ridiculous. The problem of other minds is the foundation of skepticism, and it means that we are to constantly ask for evidence concerning the mental states of other creatures. We are to ask for proof, for verification, before we can grasp them to be experiencing or undergoing given mental states. And of course, theoretically, there can be no verification. This is what Descartes labored with when he was undergoing his quite famous existential crisis. When he brought skepticism as far as it can go, he realized that he didn't even know if he himself exists. And this is what the problem of other minds leads to as well. We cannot have verification for the fact that other human beings or animals have mental states. There is no certain proof, none whatsoever. This could all be a dream. And this is the basis from which Scheler argues. He sees the problem of other minds, the question of how do we know what another creature is undergoing, to be utterly ridiculous. It's absurd. And this is because individuals are not separated from each other atomistically. The problem of other minds and skepticism presume that we are imprisoned into our own bodies, that we are ghosts in the famous machine, that there's a mind trapped in our heads, and we are completely detached from other similar individuals. There's an abyss, a gulf between us and others, and all we can do is fall into a state of solipsism, of only knowing ourselves, even if even that. And this, for Scheler, is the wrong way of approaching mentation. He felt that we are not atomistically separated from each other, nor are we imprisoned into our minds, but rather, minds develop in relation to others, and body and mind form a unity in which you cannot separate the two. They form an expressive unity where the body constantly communicates our mental states to others. And our mental states, our minds, develop in constant interaction with other creatures and their mental states until we do not know where one begins and one ends. And here, understanding others is something quite natural, quite self-evident, quite intrinsic to human understanding. And indeed, empathy here becomes something based on this embodied interaction with other beings. It's grounded on the state of intersubjectivity, which means that there's more than one, but less than two individuals in each state of interaction. This more than one, less than two comes from Donna Haraway, who has also explored the capacity to understand other animals in quite a post-structuralist context. Well, this intersubjectivity means that we are constantly, continually, really expressing our minds to others, and we understand the minds of those others quite quickly, quite immediately, without any theorizing, without any reference to inference, without any reference to theory of mind. It happens instantaneously and often goes unnoted. So we get feelings of others without being able to distinguish why we feel that somebody might be slightly peculiar or somebody might be quite nice to be around. We cannot specify why. And the reason is that our bodies are communicating with the bodies of others without our cortex, our rational ability, always being present to what happens. And this state of intersubjectivity has been also explored in the animal context. It seems to form the basis for pack or group behaviors. The instant, immediate flow of behavior in animal context is very much based on intersubjectivity. Now, so those are the four types of empathy that are most obvious in contemporary literature. Affective empathy as resonation, cognitive empathy as detached observation, projective empathy as simulation of the mental states of others, and embodied empathy as immediate embodied responding to others. Which of them could have moral relevance? Which of them is important for moral agency? I'm going to first discuss cognitive empathy. As I mentioned, it's very much based on neutrality. And this forms the troubling part, the troubling element in cognitive empathy. Because it can remain completely and utterly detached and neutral, it also enables the darker side of empathy, and that is manipulation and control of others. It's even been linked to amorality, meaning the incapacity to follow moral thought at all. It seems to entwine with existence beyond moral capacity. And the most obvious case in point here are psychopaths or narcissists, who, according to studies, are quite developed in cognitive empathy. It's often claimed that these groups of personality disorders lack empathy, but that's not true. They lack certain types of empathy, but they do have cognitive empathy. And that means that they're quite capable of, in a detached manner, observing mental states in others. And this forms the basis for why they're so successful in manipulating and controlling other creatures. They use cognitive empathy for their benefit. And this shows how cognitive empathy can coexist and entwine with amorality, existence outside moral agency. And indeed, it seems that cognitive empathy can be linked to an atomistic, highly individualistic and highly egoistic, self-directed mode of being. It doesn't make us care for others, it doesn't make us resonate with others, and instead it can serve a a utilitarian way of approaching other creatures. We can simply observe from a detached viewpoint how to best utilize other creatures for our own benefit. And this is something that cognitive empathy enables. And here's the perhaps the most radical slide of my talk. This is like a slight curiosity, just as a kind of a thought experiment. If anthropocentric attitudes were put to a personality test, what would happen? This has been done with multinational corporations, various non-personalistic, non-individualistic entities. And if we did the same, it has been done with capitalism and various collective enterprises. If we did the same to anthropocentrism, what would be the result? Now, I've listed some criteria from psychopathy here. They are manipulation, control, instrumentalization, grandioso emphasis of one's own value, calculation, egoism, hedonism, lack of guilt, and lack of effective empathy. And if we think of these criteria for psychopathy in the context of how non-human animals are often approached, it would seem that collectively our anthropocentric attitudes quite clearly fulfill the same diagnosis as to psychopaths. There's clear manipulation, very heavy control, very intrinsic instrumentalization of other animals, grandioso emphasis of human uniqueness and speciality. Calculation when it comes to using other animals, quite evident egoism, hedonism, which comes out in statements like meat is just so good, so I'm not going to give it up. Lack of guilt, yeah, and lack of effective empathy. So hence, cognitive empathy seems to make quite a poor candidate for animal ethics, animal philosophy, and indeed for any sort of moral agency. Cognitive empathy has the darker sides of empathy entwined with it. Even though we all use cognitive empathy all the time, it cannot be made the basis of moral agency. Now, what about projective empathy? Would that make a good candidate? So the studies show that it's quite important in training moral understanding of others and empathy in general. Projecting ourselves into the situations of others is highly pedagogical, highly educational. But it also comes with quite heavy problems, quite strong problems. And one of these is atonism. Projective empathy is something that Cher really quite strongly criticized. He argued that when we project ourselves into the situation of another, we are precisely presuming that we are somehow imprisoned into our own minds, and those others remain mysteries to us. And the only way that we can understand them is by imagining what we would feel in their context. But here it's important to know that we are actually transporting the I, the me, the myself, into the other being. We might remain completely blind to what that other being is undergoing. So projective empathy has a clear danger of ignoring the mental states of others. We simply imagine what we ourselves would feel were we to be them. We might not at all take into account what it's like to be that precise other individual. And these two problems, the idea that others are mysteries to us, whom we can only understand by transporting our own self into their context, are both part of the problem of atomism for Cher. And for this reason, it might not be such a fruitful grounds for moral agency. Projective empathy might lack what it takes for us to actually note the mental states of others. And in the source of animals, this is really important. So in the source of non-human animals, first of all, projective empathy can lead to anthropomorphism. where we wrongly pursue mother animals to undergo similar mental contents, mental experiences as we, as specific human beings, are undergoing. And secondly, it can also feed skepticism, because the assumption of atomism is there, the presumption that we do not know others as they are, that others remain mysteries to us, and we can only know them by this simulation or projection. This can actually feed skepticism. And indeed, in animal philosophy, the most potent critics of empathy in the animal context, they have argued that empathy is always anthropomorphic projection for which we should have more evidence. So they entwine, they interlink skepticism and anthropomorphism together as reasons to discard empathy as a valuable tool for understanding other animals. And therefore, projective empathy can lead to this idea that we cannot know what other animals feel, and that other animals become entirely inaccessible to us. Again, this is an evident danger in different forms of empathy. So if cognitive empathy struggles in making us understand why others matter morally, projective empathy struggles in making us understand others. In general, we do not understand their mental contents. And what about embodied empathy? How well would that match with moral agency? Well, I mentioned in the first slide that moral agency requires other-directedness and openness. And this means that we are something more than simply self-directed and egoistic. Our intentions are aimed towards the good of the other. This is other-directedness. And openness refers to openness towards difference. So we do not presume that others have to be like us to have moral significance. We are open to their peculiarities, even their alien nature, their complete opacity. Many phenomenologists have thought that we can indeed empathize with other animals. Maurice Merleau-Ponty and Edith Stein both celebrated the idea that there is embodied empathy towards non-human creatures, that this is a clear possibility. Merleau-Ponty maintained that there's a strange kinship between humans and other animals that indeed does form the grounds for some sort of embodied empathy. And ethologists such as Barbara Smuts have also emphasized this embodied empathy. People who do experiments on animal cognition in the environments of those animals, who spend long periods of time with primates, for instance, as Smuts did with baboons, they often start to report embodied empathy as something that begins to develop. And here intersubjectivity is really important. And I will just read one quote from Smuts. "Trust deepens, mutual attunement grows, and that elusive quality we call consciousness seems to extend beyond the boundaries of a single mind." So for her, as for the phenomenologists, embodied empathy enables a kind of immediate growing together, a notion of togetherness with others, that again, on a very immediate and direct level, reveals the mental contents of those others to us. And Smuts argues that we indeed, as a species, have for long had this capacity, but modern era has killed it off. Various Aboriginal peoples or bygone eras witnessed individuals who were completely in sync with even the animals that they would hunt. But we are quite detached from other animals these days. We have lost the capacity for embodied empathy in the context of other animals. And finally, so my argument is that embodied empathy does provide one good basis for moral agency. And finally, I will talk about effective empathy. Now, a as I mentioned, in the case of psychopathy, affective empathy is missing. And one argument that I myself have made too is that it is the lack of affective empathy that renders psychopaths amoral. So the fact that psychopaths cannot understand the concept of morality, they simply do not comprehend it. They correlate it with law. They do not understand what morality means. This could be because they lack, almost completely lack, affective empathy. They cannot resonate with others. So if somebody is in a state of suffering in front of them, they do not begin to feel suffering in themselves. They can just observe it. And because of this fact, it would seem that perhaps affective empathy is even necessary for moral agency. Perhaps we cannot have morality at all without an affective component. And this component would be affective empathy, resonation. And indeed, resonation renders us other directed. We instantly, when we perceive suffering or pain or sorrow in others, become, via undergoing that experience in ourselves, become quite other-directed, quite concerned for the other creature, without any rational ponderings on the matter. This happens quite immediately. And also, affective empathy enables openness in relation to others. And perhaps it is a counterforce for the egoism and hedonism very much dominating the contemporary consumeristic society. Perhaps we need more affective empathy. And perhaps it is quite necessary for moral agency. And like embodied empathy, it's also present in relation to non-human animals. So affective empathy is quite evident in human-animal interactions when we are really willing to note those other animals effectively. So, I'm arguing that embodied empathy and affective empathy form the key grounds, from a sentimentalist viewpoint, for moral agency. That we need embodied and affective empathy instead of projective and cognitive empathy. And what's the difference? I'm going to just really briefly talk of the difference between embodied empathy and affective empathy. Embodied empathy is based on a process of unfolding, a notion of becoming, and it's quite temporal. So it takes place right here and right now. We become almost in sync with others. We become quite entwined with the mental states of other creatures. And this is a process that takes place right here, right now. It's grounded on the notion of nowness, the present moment. And also, embodied empathy enables the recognition of differences and opacities, muddlements in others. So when we are in a state of embodied empathy, we notice that there's much that we do not understand. This is something that Scherner already accentuated. He maintained that it's important for empathy to remain also aware of how much we cannot know in other creatures. And embodied empathy enables this. We respect the mental states that remain hidden from ourselves. Affective empathy, on the other hand, the embodied empathy is future-oriented and affective empathy is based on the present moment. I got that wrong story. My cold is getting better for me. Effective empathy is based on accentuation of the present moment, so it's non-temporal. So whereas embodied empathy is constantly going towards something, it's future-oriented. Effective empathy is based on the present moment. And more importantly, effective empathy accentuates access, complete access. So whereas embodied empathy underlines the fact that we cannot know everything in another creature, effective empathy gives us the impression that we know them completely and thoroughly. So when we are in a state of resonation, we feel as if we know them fully, that there is nothing in the other creature that is not accessible to us. We know them quite thoroughly, quite fully. And this might be a mistake in effective empathy, something that embodied empathy can help us to overcome, because we, of course, never know anybody fully. And on the basis of these differences, my claim is that in the context of non-human animals, all these four components are required. So if we emphasize embodied and effective empathy as the source of moral agency, a sentimentalist source of moral agency in the animal context, in animal philosophy, we need to take into account mutual becoming, the idea that we are in a process of becoming something with other animals, that we have to take the future into account, see where we are heading, instead of just hedonistically or egoistically, constantly concentrating on the present moment and what we can gain from other animals. This notion of mutual becoming is quite significant morally. Also, secondly, we need to take difference into account. The fact that pigs or cows or fishes are not little people. They are their own quite specific, quite unique, quite often incomprehensible creatures who cannot be fully known. Yes. And thirdly, instant recognition is also important because we do have access to certain mental states immediately and instantly. So even if we do not know the animals, other animals fully or completely, there are many mental states which we can know immediately and quite thoroughly. And lastly, there is a sense of similarity between humans and other animals too, next to difference that needs to be advocated. And last slide. Levinas was quite famous for suggesting that we ought to meet other individuals outside totalizing totalitarian concepts. And this means getting beyond language and its stereotypes. We ought to see others naked, stripped bare from various cultural prejudices and stereotypes and connotations and pre-given meanings. We ought to see them naked. And this can lead to an interruptive encounter, the type of an encounter that Levinas very much emphasized and celebrated. He felt that ethics is not something grounded on rationality. It spurs from these interruptive encounters when we suddenly do witness others bare, stripped, naked from various cultural stereotypes and meanings. And it would seem to me that effective and embodied empathy can act as a background for this type of this type of a grasp of moral agency. So instead of always following rational, analytical, moral theory when it comes to other animals, which is something that predominantly happens in animal ethics, perhaps there is more room for celebrating this type of sentimentalist, empathic notion of interruptive encounters, where we suddenly see other animals stripped bare from anthropocentric notions, various cultural meanings and pre-given categories that continually otherwise predetermine how we see other animals. And perhaps embodied and effective empathy enable this. Perhaps they spark interruptive encounters. And this again would mean that there's a need to learn more embodied and effective empathy. Thank you.